Welcome to our Halloween and All Saints Spooktacular service. Full disclosure, I forgot to ask Toby to record the prelude and the postlude and the music for the prayers. So that's canned music, but the rest is all Toby and the hymns. Anyway, we're glad you joined us today. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that the land on which we gather is the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe people. The Algonquin peoples have lived on this land since time immemorial. We are grateful to have the opportunity to be present in this territory. On this All Saints Sunday, as we come to light our Christ candle, we give thanks, first of all, for all the saints who have held the Christ light for us when we had no strength to hold it ourselves. We give thanks for all the saints whose lives stand as witness to light and love, and who invite our light to join theirs. And we give thanks also for those whose work for peace and justice inspires us to learn, grow, and discover our own light in this good work of healing the world with Christ's love.
Call to worship. Come, you saints of God, let us praise and worship the God who has gathered us together this morning. We have come. Our hearts are ready to give God praise. Come, you saints of God, you who are set apart to carry out God's work in the world. We have come. We are ready to do God's will. Come, you saints of God, remember all those who have gone before us, the faithful who have carried the torch of faith and lit the way. We have come. We remember those who have helped us on our journey and accompany us still. In the communion of saints, let us worship God.
Life endures when we
opening prayer. We worship from our houses, vineyards, orchards, fields, apartments, and places of residence. We celebrate the ministry of Christ Church in this community of faith. We worship, gracious God, following the footsteps of Jesus, just as our forebears did. We remember the people of all genders and all ages who have gathered in this place, sat in these pews, and marveled at the beauty and generosity that surrounds us. We gather in the company of the saints. We honor the faith that has been handed down through the decades. For this faith and those who shared it, praise be to you, O God. Amen.
So I had this great idea a few weeks ago. I'm going to talk about the top 10 scary stories of the Bible and why they're not so scary. And so I went on the internet like I do when I'm doing some research. I was looking up what other people thought were the scariest stories of the Bible, and I found a lot of them rhymed with each other. There's a lot of the similar stories in there, but I found this list that I'm gonna share with you, and I think it is pretty scary. You know, to tell you the truth, there are some pretty scary things in the Bible. I remember when I was a kid, and I went to Sunday school and all that stuff, and you know, I was aware of many of the stories in the Bible, and a lot of it was kind of, let's just say a little sugar-coated in Sunday school, and as it should be, because boy, oh boy, there's some things in there that'll really freak you out if you just read them for the first time without any context or without a whole lot of guidance. And I was one of those kids. I saw Raiders of the Lost Ark when it came out in the early 80s. I think it was 1980 or 81. I would have been like 10 years old. And one of the first things I did was I went home and I grabbed a Bible. How many 10-year-olds do that? Anyway, I went home and I grabbed the Bible and I started looking through to try to find the story of the Ark of the Covenant. And I was reading through it, Genesis and beyond. And just as I was flipping through the Bible, reading it, I was going, wow, there are some pretty heavy-duty things in here. They're really scary stuff for a kid to read and for an adult. No matter how old you are, there are things in the Bible that are pretty, they're pretty scary. So, you know, for All Saints Day, Halloween Sunday, I thought I'd bring out those scary stories. But, you know, you can't just do that. You know, you gotta be, I think you gotta be a little careful. You gotta be reverent with the material because, you know, a lot of people, including myself, take these passages very seriously and take our scripture very seriously. It's the foundational text of our faith, so I don't want to make fun of it. But at the same time, I do want to come at it with what I think is a sense of play, because I think play is a good thing. So we're gonna go through these top 10 scary stories of the Bible and why they're not so scary. And interspersed throughout it, we're going to sing Don't Be Afraid, which we sang last Sunday in church in anticipation for today's service. So top 10 stories of the scary stories of the Bible. First one, number 10. The torment of Job. Job chapters 1, 2, and 38 to 42. Job is one of those books in the Bible that is a tough nut to crack. You know the story. Job is a righteous guy. He's a man of some means and some stature. He's got a family who he loves. And boy, things get rough for Job because, you know, the God and Satan, you know, play with him and all sorts of terrible things happened to him, and he is tormented, and people have spent thousands of years trying to figure out this book. People in my life, including myself, have spent a long time trying to figure out this book. And you know what? I'm 50 years old as of yesterday, and I haven't figured it out yet. And I'm starting to think maybe we're not supposed to figure it out. Maybe the lesson of Job is very simple, and that is that you know, God is God. God has got such power for good, and that's it. You know, when God turns the grace on, when that tap's flowing, things are fantastic, and because of their understanding, when this book was written, it was a long time ago, and this is going to come up again and again in this list, because of their understanding of God and the universe and health and all that kind of stuff and allegory, and because it was a very different culture from our own, I believe that this is in the Bible for a reason, and that it did bring some comfort to those folks who would have read it and experienced it a long time ago. Because we live in a very different world, very different context, this book is unsettling, to say the least, and I think, ultimately, for a lot of people, unsatisfying. However, if at the end of the day the story is that you've got a God who's powerful and that powerful love can bring health and wholeness, then maybe it's done its job or its job. All right, we'll go on to the next one. All right, the next one is from Daniel chapter 5, the handwriting on the wall. And you've got this king who is not a great guy and causing all sorts of problems for all sorts of people in antiquity. And he's got prisoners. He's got Daniel. He's a prisoner. Daniel is an Israelite who speaks Aramaic. And anyway, they're having a feast, and this writing appears on the wall, and they can't read it. Just this ghostly writing appears on the wall. They can't, so they bring up Daniel because Daniel speaks Aramaic, and he reads it. And what he said, the writing on the wall, that's where the saying comes from. Tells the king things that he doesn't want to hear, including that his days are numbered. That he's getting his comeuppance. And anyway, I guess that's one of the scary things in the Bible because of this kind of ghostly writing appears on the wall. So when you hear the phrase, the writing's on the wall and his days are numbered, it comes from this, Daniel 5. The more you know. Well, if you learn nothing else today, you've learned that. The next story, number 8 of the scary stories of the Bible, is one that we read just after Christmas. Matthew chapter 2, verses 16 to 18, the massacre of the innocents. And this is to fulfill a prophecy. It was a part of the story that folks would have been tracking back in those days, is that, there was going to be, something cataclysmic happen. And so we've got this story. I mean, it's awful. It's an awful story. And there's no sugarcoating it. It's awful, awful, awful. And if there is a silver lining, because it's the Bible, there has to be. If there is a silver lining, it's that Jesus and his family escaped this. So here we go, number 8. I need a break. We're going to sing, Don't Be Afraid.
Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. My love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger, and I have promised to be always near. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. My love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger, and I have promised to be always near.
Okay, we're back with number 7 on our list, the obliteration of Sodom and Gomorrah. Genesis chapter 19, verses 1 to 29. Oh, what a story this is. What terrible politics and theology have sprung forth from this. And I'll preach about that some other day. I'm sure I will. In this story, I think you all know it. God rains down fire on Sodom and Gomorrah to punish them for something. And I think what they're being punished, and I know what they're being punished for. It is they're being punished for placing people at risk and not practicing the ancient value, and it is such a high value, of hospitality. And so this is what happens. This is the consequence. This is the big bad thing that happens, is God destroys the God character. Okay, let's be careful here. Destroys the city. There's been all sorts of theories about how this has happened to kind of make a jive with science, involving comets and asteroids and stuff like that. But the narrative function is such that there was wickedness and evil and terrible things, and God destroyed those wicked and evil and terrible things. So if you were reading this back when these stories were being told, back in ancient Israel, you'd be comforted by that. You would. You really would, because there you go. You've got this God who's so powerful that could smite the wicked. And because you're not wicked, we'll protect you. So unless you aren't. So number 7, the obliteration of Sodom and Gomorrah. All right, number 6, the locusts of the abyss from Revelation. This is not the last we'll see of Revelation on this list, of course, because Revelation, the last book of the Bible, has got some very freaky stuff in it. I have not preached enough on Revelation in my career in ministry in the last 22 years. I probably preached on it maybe, I don't know, a handful of times at the Rothwell. But, you know, Revelation is a highly symbolic work. It's not meant to tell the future. None of the prophets really about telling the future, rather more about describing the present in ways that are couched in metaphor and cultural artifact. And so Revelation, well, it's the end of the world, folks. It's the end of the world, which is scary enough as it is. And then you bring in things like locusts and people getting eaten and tormented. Well, you know, it's scary. Scary stuff. And we'll come back to Revelation in a little bit. But anyway, that's number six. The locusts and the abyss. Number five. The 10 plagues of Egypt. Exodus chapter 7 verses 14 all the way through to chapter 12 verse 29. Now, I mean, if you've seen the 10 commandments and if you've seen the cartoons and have heard the stories, you know what's going on here. You know, God's not happy. Not happy at all with the way that the Israelites are being treated. And so, you know, there's some coercion that needs to happen to the powers that be in Egypt, and that comes in the form of plagues and awful stuff happening to them. And, you know, when you're a 10-year-old and you're looking for the stories of the Ark of the Covenant, you come across this kind of stuff and you're like, whoa, when's this guy going to fall on us? So, yeah, that's another scary story. Number five, plagues of Egypt. Number four, the flood of Noah. Genesis chapter 6, verses 9 all the way to 8:22. Chapter 8:22. Now, again, this is a story that I learned from a very, very young age. In fact, I can't remember a time in my life when I didn't know the story of Noah. And it's cute. I mean, it's made cute. You've got like your ark and little animals coming into it, and everybody's safe, and it's cute. It's you know, cartoons have been made, toys, toy sets, kids' books, puzzles, you name it. They've found a way to market this story, and it is a nice story until you think about it for more than 10 minutes, and you're like, oh my goodness, wow, just one family? Okay, and the rest is like flooded out and drowned? Yeah, that's unsettling. And you can read parts, so you keep going in the story. One of the things I'm afraid about is Pixie barking during these videos, but I'm not going to bother with it. It's okay. It's all right. Maybe she's scared of these stories. But then you read on, and then God promises not to do it again by a flood, and you get the rainbow, and that's very nice too. But there's still all that destruction. And we'll come back to, well, you know, the whole point of this is why they're not so scary. So we'll come back to this at the end of the list. What are we going to do? Oh, we're going to sing again. So let's take a break. Let's take a break and sing Don't Be Afraid.
Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. My love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger.
Number three, God's judgment against Jerusalem, Ezekiel chapter 22, verses 17 to 22. Well, here we go, into these books of the prophets, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Isaiah. Again, more scary stuff. You know, the idea is that, you know, as long as the people are not sinning, and as long as the people are living according to the law and keeping the covenant and not worshiping idols, as long as they're doing all those things, they are allowed to stay in the Holy Land, and things will be great. I mean, they're not always great, but they'll be there, because that's the most important thing, really. I mean, salvation for the ancient Israelites was to live in the land that God promised them. And the deal is that they've got to do it in such a way that God has commanded by adhering to all of these rules and laws, which are all about community building, really. But when, you know, the idea is that when they're not doing these things, well, that's it. You are turfed out of Israel. And this gets borne out by the Babylonian exile and just the calamity that ensued for quite some time for these folks. And so this is another story of, you know, this being prophesied and God, you know, it's not good. And it's scary because they are being forcibly removed from their homes. They are displaced. And, you know, if you're not scared by that, I don't know what you're scared of, because that's another scary story in the Bible. Now this one, I mean, we know this one. Number two, the Passion of Christ, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Foundational story to our faith. And I go back to my childhood watching that movie, Jesus of Nazareth. And I used to play it around Easter time. And I do remember when I was really young, I watched it with my family. And I, you know, when they're actually doing the crucifying part, like that, just, I still remember how I felt and the actor's face, and it just made that story that we told on Good Friday and Easter just all the more visceral and poignant and terrifying. And I thought, like, as I was going through this list and I was putting this service together, and I don't want to be flip about this. I don't, because this is a scary thing. It's sad. But at the same time, it is a foundational event that I believe leads us to identify with God, that helps us identify with God's love for victims, and also standing up for what you really believe to be important and how you protect, ultimately, the lives of those you love. And sometimes that means sacrificing yourself to do that. That is scary. That is sad. But it's not the end of the story. And the crucifixion story without the resurrection story remains a horror story. This is a act leading up to the happy ending, the ones that we continue to live today. So, I remember being terrified of this scene in that Jesus of Nazareth movie. You probably saw it too. It was on TV every year for the longest time. So I think it belongs on this list. And treated seriously within the play. All right, number one. I didn't put the list together. Full disclosure, I got it from some website. And I read a lot of websites, like I said, about this whole scary stories of the Bible. And they all did rhyme with each other. And a lot of these showed up on all these lists. But this one's definitely, you know, just the visual of it. Like, I don't know how many heavy metal album covers relied on this particular story from Revelation. Chapter 19, verse 20, and then 20, 10, 14, it just keeps going. And the lake of fire is where, occurs in Revelation. And that's where the most wicked of the wicked, like the beast, the Antichrist, that's where they get their comeuppance. And that's where they get thrown in the lake of fire, where they will be tormented for, I think it says 1,000 years. I have a hard time remembering numbers. But anyway, that's a long time. So just the visual of a lake of fire and people within it, that ought to scare the pants out of you. And it does. And that heavy metal and albums and bands, you know, rely on that sort of cultural memory of this. And that's why you get this imagery, because it's supposed to be a little bit frightening. And Halloween's all about being afraid in a fun way. So, there's the fun and then there's the comforting part. So We're going to move on. We're going to sing Don't Be Afraid again.
Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. My love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger.
Okay, so we've gone through our list of scary stories in the Bible. One of the most oft repeated phrases in all of Scripture is, "Don't be afraid." Then they put all these stories in that are really scary. Why are they not so scary? I believe, at least when it comes to my faith life and my theology, when it comes to the Bible, is that, this it's not a book. It's a compilation of books. And even within the books themselves, there are layers of edits. I mean, you can read Scripture and you can see, people who are a lot smarter than I am, but once you read the books from the smarter people, you can sort of see where they're getting at. Even books within the Bible have multiple authors. And there's like layers upon layers, and there's edits that happen. So this Scripture itself was never like dictated by like God or an angel and just written down by some dude thousands of years ago. That's not it at all. It is an anthology. It is a collection. It was a living and a breathing document and chronicle of our ancient forebears' relationship with God. And because it was compiled and written and edited across time and space, the culture was necessarily, and of course, different from ours. So you can't just pick up the Bible and read it as if everything in there, and this is where people might disagree with me, and that's okay. You know, diversity is a wonderful thing, and we need all sorts of different voices. But you can't read it as if all of it like happened exactly like that. Like if I tell the story of what I picked up at the grocery store earlier today, I went and I got some olive oil, and I got some milk, and I got this Korean noodle meal kit. That's what I did. You know, if I told that story, that's what I did. It was a factual recounting of what I did. That's not what the Bible, I believe, is about. It is allegory, it is symbolic, it is metaphor. And yeah, sure, you know, a lot of these folks most likely lived and breathed as human beings, but their stories are true in a different way than me telling you what I bought at the grocery store. It doesn't mean it's less true. It's true in a different way. And that's how I continue forward with my faith journey. So all of that to say is that all of these stories were there to convey a sense of God's love, unconditional and undying love of God's people as the people of Israel and as people as individuals. And having a strong God who was capable of doing things like sending plagues, or, you know, poor Job and lakes of fire and all that stuff, capable of doing all those things to people who deserved it. How capable is God in showing love and affection and blessing to those who enjoy God's favor? So that was the comfort. was a brutal time. The world map was, I mean, I guess there's lots of similarities if you really think about it, but really a brutal time. And countries and city-states and empires were ruled over by strong men. And so their gods reflected that. So if you were a country like, or a nation or a people like Israel, you wanted a strong God who was on your side. And that strength, even though it was meted out in, as the stories go, in really scary ways, that strength was love, experienced as such by the people who were the heroes of the story, i.e. the Israelites. Like even when bad things happened to them, and you know, people do this now too, even when bad things happened to them, it was, I don't believe this, but people do, and it was in the Bible, it was God doing the bad things for reasons that were God's, and if they were God's reasons, well then they were good. That's the story of Job, also in there. So why are they not so scary? Well, because it's a love story. And it was an experience of people who felt God's love in ways that were different perhaps than the way that you feel it. It's not so scary because it's all about grace. It's all about God coming through for God's people in ways that they may not have realized it, but God coming through nonetheless. And so you think about it in that light. You think about how we understand God's love and grace in our lives. And if God's willing to go to such lengths and can go through to such lengths to show God's justice and love for people back in antiquity, well, if we're talking about the same God and the same Spirit, then God's still coming through in ways that are just as loving and I think just as powerful in ways that we experience differently today, or at least understand differently. So that same power of God to change hearts and minds, to save people from themselves, to help people with addiction, to help people find help for psychological things, for mental health reasons, for physical problems, you know, the same God who inspires people to become doctors, paramedics, or whatever, you know, to help save lives. That same God who moves us to acts of compassion, great and small. The same God who moves the helpers, as Mr. Rogers used to talk about. That same God, that same love, that same power is here. And that's the story. So, yeah, these stories are scary. But they're not so scary, if you think about them, as experienced by their original hearers, as acts of love from a graceful God. Now, personally, I'm glad that we experience it differently these days. Amen.
Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. My love is stronger than yours.
Hello, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Oh, I'm not too bad. Here we go. This, you know, this could be our last Thursdays with Trina.
Yes.
Because the big news is lots of people already know, but we're going back to live in-person worship starting next Sunday, November 7th, because it's Remembrance Day. And we had a council meeting just before just before, well, a couple of weeks ago, really. And, you know, I put the question to them, do you think it's time to go back to every Sunday? And the resounding answer was yes. So there you go.
Excellent.
It'll be the last Thursdays with Trina.
Yep.
So let's make it count. So what we've been doing is our numbers, we're being so careful. And honestly, if you want to blame anybody for how careful we're being, just blame me. Because I have honestly, folks, I've buried 12 people who've died of COVID, including a service that I have just next week, as a matter of fact, another woman who's died of COVID, and she just died a couple of weeks ago. So it's very real to me. And I'm erring on the side of caution because I absolutely love all of you and I want to be careful, but at the same time, I want to be realistic. And so the way the case count's going and what the Ottawa Public Health is telling us, mm-hmm. I feel like we're okay to kind of ramp up a little bit. I think it's okay. So we were at 15% capacity for the few times we've gathered so far. And roughly our sanctuary holds 200 people. So 15% is 30. So if we're going to go up to 30%, that would be 60. So we thought we would do that. We thought we would come back every Sunday and we would increase it to 30% capacity. So 60 people. And I think that's a good place to start.
Yeah,
so we're going to do that. The other thing that we're going to do, and you will be very, everyone will be very happy about this, is we're going to put out the hymn books. They will be on the back table. So when you come in, grab the hymn books. So grab your bulletin, grab mm-hmm. your Voices United, grab mm-hmm. your More Voices United, and that will be your, you know, that'll be your worship kit, and you can bring that in. And that will save us from having to photocopy all the lyrics. But for those of you who read music, you'll be able to read the music while you sing it, which is a good thing. So that's what we've decided to do for now. So that's so, you know, we've got some work to do, Trina. We got to get those hymn books out of the choir room and.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
We'll do that. And, yep. So there's that. There's the reopening saga. And I said a little while ago, and I'm not like any kind of future teller, but my sense was that the reopening would come with its own social stresses. You know, like I think there would be some people who would be quicker to reopen than others. And that causes tension and perhaps hopefully not conflict, but at least tension and feelings of whatever. So, so we're being careful. And so for those of you who think that maybe we're not opening up and ramping up and getting, you know, things back to normal as quickly as maybe you would prefer, just know that it's all being done thoughtfully. And it's not perfect. You know, it's our first pandemic. This is our first reopening from a pandemic. So we're not going to be good at it. All right. So, Trina, what else is going on?
Well, obviously it's Halloween.
Obviously, and that's a perfect costume for you because you're kind of the sheriff around the building.
I am. I'm the sheriff. See, yeah, exactly. I've got my sheriff badge, and yes. So today I decided to come as the sheriff. So I've got my red blacks hat on.
Oh, great!
It's supposed to be lucky, but if you know what kind of football season we are having,
not good.
Not good, but it also works for this. So that's fun. So it's been a fun week here. We've had crazy hair day at the daycare. They've had crazy hat day. I think everybody's in pajamas today. And I guess tomorrow will be the actual costume. So it's been a ton of fun around here all week. So I decided to join in and decide to wear my costume today. So,
well, I did the best I could. I'm wearing my orange t-shirt, my black. So I kind of feel like I'm look like a pumpkin.
Exactly. Very good.
So you're handing out candy this year at your house?
Oh yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I think I've got this little dog that goes crazy when anybody approaches my house, and the thought of a couple of hours of that is not all that appealing. But I think maybe what I'll do is I'll sit out in the porch, I'll bundle up, sit on the porch, maybe put some scary music on the old Bluetooth speaker, and hand out some candy that way.
So I've got my monster sweater I always wear, and I'm planning to wear my black mask. And this might be a good idea, you know, for people who are not too sure about giving out candy, but I think I'll be wearing a mask when I greet my trick-or-treaters just because they're in my door.
You know, what we could do is I could set up a table and just put a big bowl of candy and sort of sit back from it. And that way I'll have my 6 foot distance and I'll have my mask on. And that way it's as safe as possible. The other thing is, and this is something you learn when you have a child who uses a wheelchair. Well, child, she's 17. My goodness. She's getting to be an adult next year, but with using the wheelchair, a lot of houses in Orleans have got these beautiful stairs and steps up to their houses that look great, but not great for people who use wheelchairs. So you never know. You never know when somebody who uses a mobility aid might come your way. So I think it's be good to be accommodating. So anyway, that's Halloween. That's exciting. I'm glad it's on. I think I'll try this out. I think Halloween should always be on the last Saturday of October. That's the way I think it should be. Mm-hmm. I think it should be a movable feast, like Thanksgiving or Labor Day or Easter. So that way you could have it on a Saturday. But anyway, people don't tend to listen to me, so that's okay.
No, and it's supposed to pour rain too, again, as always, for Halloween. Yeah.
Fall in Ottawa. And on Saturday,
candy.
I hit the half century mark.
Oh yes! Oh yeah! You're right.
I will have turned 50 yesterday. So.
Oh right. I have a few. Let's see here. I'm just going to kind of surprise you, but
no.
See what I got. Here you go. You see that? 50.
Yes. Oh, I'm touched.
Go. Left over from my party, maybe a couple of years ago, maybe. We won't say how many, but well used.
Oh, thank you. Oh my gosh. Yeah, we're gonna go out to lunch.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. I got both boys are not working on Saturday, and my parents and I were in Sabina, and the whole group of us are gonna meet for lunch, and that'll be nice.
Great.
And but that's after our worship committee meeting. So Saturday morning, we're having a worship committee meeting with Toby, our new music director, to start planning Christmas. So now that we know that we can have people back, and now that we've got hymn books, and now that we've got an interim music director, I'm excited. I'm so excited to start planning Christmas. I'm super stoked about that. And Remembrance Day too, of course. That's extremely important. But anyway, it just feels good that we can start planning again and start getting in there and doing stuff. All right. So that's something else wonderful has happened. What's that?
Well, yes, you'll see in the announcement page this adorable baby, Carson Miles McKay, son of Robin and Scott McKay, born October 25th, 11:31, tiny, 4 pounds 9 ounces, due sort of a month early.
Came a little early. Yeah.
A little early. Of course, grandparents, Ruth and Ron McKay. And of course, the siblings, Hannah, Zachary, and of course, great aunt, Eva Jarman.
Yes. And great grandson of Des and Betty Jarman too.
Exactly.
The river of life, it flows on. And Hannah and Zachary, they're delightful kids. And I'm sure Carson will be absolutely loved and adored by so many people in his church family. So I'm super happy about that. All right. Yeah. I think we need to go because as you will have seen in this video, it's longer than the normal one because I just couldn't help myself and I went just bananas with it. So anyway.
We'll see. Okay.
All
have
right.
Fun.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Invitation to offering. All the rules of our faith can be summed up in the law of love for God and one another. Everything hangs on that, the law of love. We don't just want to talk about love here. We wish to bring it to life in ministry. We offer hospitality. We build community. We act in compassion. We do justice work. And in all these things, we worship and love God. And we offer our love to our neighbor. That is what this ministry and our gifts are about. And all of it hangs on love.
The gift of creation, the gift of your love, for the gift of the Spirit by which we live. We thank you and give you the fruit of our hands. May our grace be proclaimed by the gifts that we give.
Offering prayer. Great calling God, we dedicate these offerings and our lives to you and your way, as have the saints of the past. Bless them, multiply them, use them as you will. Amen.
Now quit your care and anxious fear and worry, for schemes are vain and fretting brings no gain. Let pause to prayer, to trust and dedication. God brings you beauty nigh. Reply, reply, reply with love to love most high. Reply, reply, reply with love to love most high. To bow the head in sackcloth and in ashes, or rend the soul, such grief is not Lent's goal, but to be led to where God's glory flashes, God's beauty to come near, make clear, make clear, make clear where truth and truth appear, make clear, make clear, make clear where truth and light appear. For is our God the fast that I have chosen to those who flee, a shelter every yoke of wickedness, a grievous bond to loosen, oppression bond to flight, to flight, to flight, till every wrong set right. To fight, till every bone set right. For righteousness and peace shall show their faces to those who feed the hungry in their need and wrongs redress, to build the old places. Divine, divine, divine it is when all combine. Divine, divine, divine it is when all combine. Then shall your light break forth as does the morning. Your health shall spring, the friends you make shall bring God's glory bright, your way through life adorning, and large be the prize. Arise, arise, arise and make a paradise. Arise, arise, arise up in the paradise.
A wonderful someone has happened. Congratulations to Scott McKay and to Robin for the birth of Carson McKay, great-grandson of Des Jarman, grandson of Ruth McKay. Everyone is healthy and doing wonderfully. Good news. God bless you, little dude. Well, in keeping with the spirit of the day, Halloween and All Saints Sunday, I went to the internet to look for some prayers or some Christian sayings about Halloween, and you know, there's quite a few actually, and here's one that struck my fancy. Not because I necessarily agree with it, but anyway, gives you another take on a jack-o'-lantern. It's called "Christians are like pumpkins. God picks you from the patch, brings you in, washes off all the dirt, some of which you may have got from other pumpkins. Then he cuts the top off, scoops out all the yucky stuff. He removes seeds of doubt, hate, greed, unforgiveness, etc. Then he carves a new smiling face and puts his light inside you to shine for all the world to see. Are you letting your light shine? Be a jack-o'-lantern for Jesus." I guess that's one way to think about it. And here's another one. This is called "A Prayer for Halloween." This one's a little bit nicer, I think. "God of laughter and joy, we turn to you in the way of our ancient ancestors, grateful for the abundance of food and festivity that surrounds us this time of year. Keep all children safe as they embark on their Halloween revels. Light their way through the dark night and enfold them in love. May the real treat in their lives be grace that multiplies in depth and breadth as they grow older. We pray this with all the saints in heaven. Amen." Well, see, that's one that I could get behind. I'd like that one. And now turning to the other holiday that we mark today, All Saints Day, I have a prayer from Morgan Bell that I quite like and like to share it with you and with God, of course, right now. "O Ancient of Days, we thank you for the faith of our ancestors in Christ. We pray for that great cloud of witnesses, saints of fame and obscurity, holy people, both ancient and contemporary, the faithful persecuted for your sake, righteous forebears who brought your gospel to life through theirs. As we pray for all the saints and all their forms, we also pray that we may be as faithful as they were, and in so doing, become more like Jesus each day. We pray with the hope of the resurrection and the life which is in Christ Jesus, who lives in glory with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, then, now, and always. Amen." And we continue to pray out of celebration for the abundance that we enjoy in our society, in our lives, and in our hearts and minds. Most importantly, for the love that we have from you, God, that love that we share with each other and our own best selves. We give you thanks for all of those who are working for the good in our society. And there are a lot of them. We give you thanks for Carson, a new baby for Scott and Robin. Scott, grandson of Des Jarman, son of Ruth McKay. God, we're grateful for new beginnings. We also pray for those who are struggling, those who are grieving, those who are waiting test results, those who are recovering from surgery, all of those who are lonely. God, we pray and you listen. And so we come to you in these moments of silence, confident that you will hear us in our thoughts. You will feel our feelings. You will listen within this quiet. And we continue to pray as Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen."
Commissioning and benediction. As you go about your week, think about the saints in your life and the blessings you have received from them. Let us leave this time together, renewed and inspired by those who have lived as saints before us and among us. May we continue to grow in our faith as we seek to live in the way of Jesus. Amen.
Well, that's a wrap for this week. My thanks to Toby, to Angela, to Sabina, and to Trina for helping me put all of this together. We will see you next week live and in person for our Remembrance Day service, and every other week after that, because that's when we start back for good. So in the meantime, folks, be gentle with yourselves, be gentle with each other. God bless until we meet again. Something weird, and it don't look good. Who you gonna call? Jesus.